Greetings everybody, this is a old video I produced some years back on candle making. Unfortunately the audio is not very good because the camera I was using was not a particularly good quality one, and the audio unfortunately did suffer, so I've decided rather than making you endure the terrible glitchy audio, I would re-record and basically give you a rundown of what's going on here and what I did. I can still remember, even though this room and all the bench and everything is now history, is long gone. There's a greenhouse standing where I'm currently at. So I'm just taking the temperature of this molten wax. I've got a thermometer. I've still got this equipment, incidentally. I kept it. I haven't made anything lately, but I probably will start making some more, hopefully. In my hand I have a spool of proper candle wick. You can buy it in various sizes, various types, for the kind of candles you're planning to make. I bought quite a lot because I was in it semi-commercially, so I had quite a few spools of that. Okay, I'm just about to cut it to length. The containers I'm using, the one that looks black is actually blue dye, and the one next to it, which is plain cold water, are hot dog jars. They were the longest glass container which I had readily available. So I thought for making this demonstration and for doing these smaller taper candles, this would be ideal. So I've just measured the candle wick roughly to the size I want it. I should be dunking the wick into this jar of molten candle wax very soon. And there we go. When you do this, the temperature incidentally should be the digital thermometer that it's a mechanical thermometer, actually not a digital one. Take it up to the red mark and no further. That will give you an adequate heat and an adequate melting temperature for this wax. You don't want it too high because it's wasteful, and you've got a more of a risk of the candle wax catching fire if it's giving fumes, and you really don't need it. You need it so it retains the heat but doesn't get stupidly hot. Okay, well I dunked the wick into the cold water, which hardens that first coat of wax. You've got to make sure you do that. Just straighten the wick up slightly, as you will see. Redunk it in the wax, and it's basically just a repeat. So it's out of the wax, into the cold water. Unless you dunk the whole wick length under, then you've got to be careful. You need to leave a little bit at the top which is uncoated, unless you prefer to do it coated, of course. I prefer to leave a little bit as it should be because it means less messing around at the end. The reason you don't want to dunk it underwater is obviously it's not protected, it's not waterproof like the candle will be itself. So if you get the wick wet, then obviously you won't be able to light the thing until the wick eventually dries. So if you're planning to use a candle fairly soon, then make sure you don't immerse that naked end, if you like, under the water. That incidentally is just plain cold water. Now every dip you'll see increases the diameter of that candle. It's straightforward. There's no drips on the floor or no drips on the bench. Every now and again, because as you dip it'll build up a little whisker at the end, you need to just chop that off right up to where the end of the wick is, otherwise it'll just get so skinny and so long it'll look really weird and it won't be any good. So you just dunk it out the wax straight into the cold water let the water drip off, of course, straight back into the wax, and you keep repeating this process over and over again until you reach the desired width for your candle. Bearing in mind that you've got to keep the candle within sensible limits, otherwise it'll get too big for the jar eventually if you just keep doing it. And of course, the larger diameter of the candle, you've got to remember the wick will not be suitable unless it's a larger wick for a very thick candle, purely because the wax needs to burn away cleanly without shelling, without leaving that sort of pit in the center. You really don't want that effect. And of course, the thing with tapered candles is you do need to remember they are not meant to be burnt freestanding. That's the most important point. Freestanding is not a good idea. These are the type of candles you need to size them and have proper candlestick holder or proper candle holders, candlesticks if you like, to place them in. I mean, they will stand up freely, but it's very inadvisable to do so. You can see the actual candle itself is beginning to form into some sort of shape, and this shape occurs naturally. You don't have to do anything at all other than what I'm doing here, which is just dunking in straight out into the cold water and back again. It's repetitive, and your arm will probably ache if you just keep plodding on like I'm doing here. Obviously, you can take a break. You don't have to keep doing this constantly. I do it purely because I'm doing this video and I wanted to show you the process so you could see for yourself. It doesn't take very much time at all to build a decent sized candle. The important thing to remember also is people say, well, why do you need the jar of water? Okay, well, there are various reasons for such. The first being, and the most important being, is if you didn't have that, if you just kept dunking the candle in, it would eventually start sagging and a whole lot. It would build up to a certain width, a diameter, but because it would be really hot and not have a chance to temper in the cold water, you would find at some point the weight of the wax would just make the thing, the whole lot slip off the wick. So you would end up back at square one. And I have had somebody comment in this video, or one of the videos I did, about taper candles, expressing the fact that the guy bought his kids a candle making kit and he was very disappointed with it because all they ended up with was a piece of string with nothing on it, and that is the reason you have the bath there, to cool the wax so it gives the next coat a chance to stick on there, and it also keeps the heat of the candle down, otherwise it would just slump. Even doing that, even the water bath step, the candle still remains very pliable, extremely pliable. So this step is very important. Secondly, the other reason for the water bath is the candle wax itself, after being dunked in cold water in this process, is extremely highly glossy, which makes the candle very attractive in itself. People make candles, sometimes they use them, sometimes they just make them for decoration, and also to light them on high days and holidays. I'm using paraffin wax as opposed to soy wax or soya wax. I have both. I don't particularly like working with soya. It's very soapy and very soft, and it's got a very creamy texture, whereas paraffin wax produces a much harder, and to my way of thinking, a much nicer candle. Although people do say, oh well, you know, we want to be green, we want to produce, you know, not produce things that are made with petrochemicals. Well, nearly everything you buy or use, and even food, is made with petrochemicals. So I wouldn't worry about candles. It really isn't essential, it isn't important, and it won't make a blind bit of difference to anything. Soy candles do tend to burn a bit faster. They are more prone to slumping if they get hot, so you can't really use them in like a lantern situation where you can get away with that. Excuse me, you can get away with that with a paraffin wax candle. That little device there, I'm just demonstrating actually, just showing you actually what it is. If you want to make multiple candles instead of just the one at a time, you can produce something like that little frame that I just picked up, and that was designed for making four candles at once. So if you've got the spacings right, you can actually attach four separate wicks to each of those ends of the frame and make four candles at once, so they'll grow equally. They'd be exactly the same diameter, exactly the same length, if you've got four jars of wax, which can either be the same color or different colors. It makes no difference, whatever your preference happens to be. So that is the candle. You can see it didn't take very long, a few minutes, and you've got a nice taper candle. The ideal scenario now, I'm going to light it just to show you it burns nicely. People always want to see the end result and see the thing actually being lit. But the ideal scenario is, once you've made your candle, don't be in too much of a hurry to light it, and everybody wants to. But the thing is, you really need to let that candle temper and cool off. Although it's been dunked in the water, it's still hot. Well, not deadly hot, not hot enough to burn you, but it's hot enough to slump, and it's not really suitable for using until it's hardened. That wax needs to harden right off. So my ideal suggestion is just leave it somewhere, room temperature, overnight, and by the next day it'll be tempered and you'll have a perfectly decent candle. I've only done this to show you that it's simple to make. The process is very simple. It's probably the one of the most simple candles you can make. You don't need molds. All you need is a proper bit of wick or cotton string. You can use cotton string. The kind of cotton string that butchers tie up meat joints with, that kind of string, that will work. Obviously, do not use anything plastic, because that won't work and it will give off poisonous fumes. So you definitely don't want to be using anything plastic. So normal, natural cotton string is fine. Not the very hairy stuff, that also is not very good. You want the close twined cotton string, or alternatively, if you've got the funds to do so and if you've got the interest, then by all means go to a candle manufacturer or a candle supplier and you can buy the wick. You can buy the dyes, everything you need for candle making, obviously the wax. You can always scavenge wax from restaurants, because when they have candle lit tables, they never let the candles burn right down to the end. There's always a piece left over. So if you go to restaurants, just make a point of saying, do you mind if we have your leftover bits of candle? I'm sure they'd be quite happy to give you them. You can collect them up together, any color, any shape, any type, it doesn't matter. Just dump them all together in a boiler, a double boiler, and hey presto, you've got your wax. It's very important, incidentally, I didn't mention this, I don't think I did, but when you're heating the wax in a jar, in a glass jar, start from cold and heat it up from cold. Don't just put the jar in hot water, because it will probably shatter, or certainly crack, and it'll be useless, so you'll have wasted your wax and a lot of time and effort. Heat the jars gently, they go right up to boiling, no problem, but you must remember to avoid any thermal shock to the glass. It won't like that at all. those jars aren't made for, they're not made for quick changes of temperature. They're food containers, basically. Always be careful with jars of wax around kids. Don't, or children, I should say. Don't like the term kids. That reminds me of goats. Just keep your wax covered. Put a lid on it, or put it safely out the way, or put it back in the boiler if you're planning to do more. Just make sure children cannot tip them over, because believe me, second degree or third degree burns with candle wax is probably the worst thing that can happen to you. The stuff will stick to you and it will just completely take the skin right off. Wherever it's on your body, it will take the skin right off, which can be a very serious injury. So be very, very careful with this stuff. But be careful, enjoy yourselves, and I hope you've enjoyed this video. I'm sorry about the fact that I've had to narrate on top of this, but it was necessary. But thanks very much for watching. All the best with your home candle making.